Hello everyone, thank you for joining the webinar, What's New in Dynamics 365 Business Central version 17. I'm very happy to present today's topic as only a couple of weeks ago, the new version of Business Central was launched. And today, Stefano Demiliani, Microsoft MVP and the author of many successful IT books, will share with us the fresh insights on the new version. My name is Ieva, and I will be moderator of today's webinar. As we have live webinar, and me and Stefano are in the different countries, so I would like to apologize in advance if there will be any technical issues during the webinar. Of course, I hope that we will not have such, but in case we will have. I think that most of you already know Simplanova, but for all who haven't worked with us before, just shortly about our company. Our main area of expertise is upgrades, and we started 7 years ago with classic to RTC upgrades, and at the moment, we specialize more and more with transition to extensions. We offer not only the upgrade and development services, but also we released a couple of years ago the automated tools for upgrading classic NEV solutions to RTC. And now our team is working on the tools which will automate transition to extensions. I think that next year we will release the first version of our tools and you will have possibility to try them. Our team already analyzed the new Dynamics 365 Business Central version 17 and what concerns the path for upgrading, so it should be the same as it was with version 15 and 16. So first of all, you will have to upgrade to 14 version latest CUCL and then to convert your solution to extensions. At the moment, we already offer free evaluations to 17th version. So if you would like to know scope for your or your customer solution to upgrade to it, so do not hesitate to contact us. And together with the evaluation, you will receive additional extensions analysis where you will see the list of objects which will need the code refactoring or an alternative solution in connection to extensions limitations. So just connect us and we will provide you the free evaluation and analysis. So finally, getting back to today's topic, I would like to ask you to share your insights in the chat if you have already tested the 17th version of Business Central. It will be really interesting for us, for me and Stefano. On the other hand, if you will have any questions during the webinar, so just submit them in the Q&A section. And at the end of the webinar, we will have a Q&A session, and we will try to answer all of these questions. And finally, as always, participants of the webinars are asking about the recording of the webinar and the slides. So definitely tomorrow by email, all the participants of the webinar will receive not only the recording, but also the slides of all the webinar. And now, I would like to invite Stefano to continue with the main today's topic and to share really fresh insights on the new Dynamics Business Central version 17.
Thanks, Ieva, and thanks to be here to this webcast. My name is Stefano Demiliani. I'm from Italy. So here are quick contacts about me if you want to reach me for other Q&A after this webcast. We have a lot of things to say today. So we'll cover all the news about Business Central version 17 And I've divided all the news that I want to share with you in three main categories. So we'll see what's new for administration part, what's new for the application part, and what's new for the developers part. And we'll have a Q&A at the end of this session. We have a lot to do, say, so expect to see lots of information. We start with the administration part. So one of the first news that comes with Business Central 17 was related to the environments. With Business Central 17, Microsoft has announced that every Business Central customer with all the premium license or the essential subscription will use one production environment and free sandbox environment at no cost. So that means that every new customer that you start with Business Central 17 can use one production environment and free sandbox linked to this production environment without cost. And customers can also choose to purchase any number of other additional production environments. This can be done not directly by the customer, but contacting their CSP partner. And linked to each production environment, to each new production environment you acquire, you will have other free additional sandboxes. That means that also that existing customers that has or the premium or the essential subscription purchased before October 1st will continue to maintain their existing environments for a period of 1 year. So without extra cost or something like that. Period of 1 year or until the subscription is renewed or ended. So first, of course, first wins. Production and sandbox environment can be created on every country. So you can acquire a different production environment as many as you want, and you can create this production and sandbox environment on any country you want, so any localization you want. And when customers create a new environment and then assign users to these new environments, remember that each user, by default, get access to all the business central environments, so sandbox and production. The license covers all these environments, so a user can access the entire environment you have. And obviously, an administrator can limit that access. So an administrator should limit that access if needed by changing the permissions or by renewing the user's access to that environment. So this is the main news related to environment. Another new feature connected to the environment is that actually on the admin center you have a new panel where you can monitor the overview or complete overview of the database and the file capacity of your Business Central tenants, and you can see how much this your database is large. How your space is distributed inside your tenants, and this new capacity page overview gives you a total overview of your the status of your tenant. This is extremely important to be monitored, because in the cloud you will start paying for the space, so you will have an 80 gigabytes of space available, and extra space must be acquired by contacting Microsoft, and customers can purchase additional database capacities and additional environments, as said before, not directly, but contacting their selling partner, their CSP, and these CSPs must create a request to Microsoft by mentioning the new add-ons types of features that you want to acquire, called Business Central Database Capacity and Business Central Additional Environment Add-ons. And this permits to your customer to acquire new environments and new capacity. And very quickly, to start showing this, this is an example. So this is my environment. On my online tenant, I have different environments. So one production and free sandbox. As you can see here, the production environment is actually, as you can see here, the production environment is on versions not upgraded yet. So capacity, the new capacity plan, just let me just refresh the environment. As you can see here, I have only one environment on version 17. What the other are actually on version 70.5. And the new capacity tab analyzes your environment quota, and it starts analyzing the environment only from the environment that are on version 17. So the environment with that are on version 16.5 are not actually counted on this analysis. And this analysis covers shows all the database capacity. And remember that there are two types of analysis here that you can see. The first is the database capacity, and the second is the file capacity. This means that the database capacity is the real user, the DR database content that you have, so the DR data that you have inside the database, so inside your tables and so on. And the file storage is instead calculated based on the size of the media tables. So media tables means the tenant media table and the tenant media thumbnails tables. So file capacity contains only, is composed only by that quota. And from here you can see your storage, how your storage is divided, and if you need to acquire more capacity or not. Related to this, remember also that if you exceed the paid database storage limit, this don't mean that your customers is blocked or Microsoft blocks your work. So if you overcome this limit, this will not occur in an interruption of business. So transaction will continue to work. And if you overcome this capacity, it means that customers won't be able to create new environments or won't be able to create new environments based on the copy of an existing environment. So until you acquire new capacity or you decrease your actual capacity, you are blocked only on these two actions. But the business, we can continue to work. Another new features is related to automation APIs. Automated APIs are possibilities that you via APIs to automate things related to the admin center. So the automate things related to automation of operations, like installing extensions, creating environments, or something like that. And actually, with Business Center 17, so, it supports what is called the service-to-service authentication. It means that you can create on your Azure Active Directory an application permission scope called automation.read-write-all and enable this permission in order to use an outflow called service-to-service. And this permits you to use automation APIs without by using OAuth and without using credentials, user credentials, something like that. So a new features, I think, are absolutely interesting if you want to automate things on your tenant. Another interesting features with Business Center 17 is the feature management page. And starting from Business Center 17, well, Microsoft release features for new features or improvement of existing features. Starting from Business Center 17, Microsoft has the right of not enabling, immediately enabling these features, but an administrator can go into the feature management page, and this page will list all the upcoming features that you can try on your tenant. And obviously, recommendation is do that on a SandBox environment. But from this page, when a feature is enabled, it becomes available to all your users. And as you can see in this image, this is the image of a feature, what you can see in the feature management page. You can see a list of features that Microsoft has planned to release in preview, And in this page, you have an indication of when this feature will become available for all automatically by Microsoft. So the automatically enabled from field shows that, for example, the first feature will become available in version 18 automatically. And you can enable this feature for all users, for example, or a set of users. When this feature is enabled from Microsoft, you will not see anymore this feature into the feature management page. Some of this feature, some features can be enabled and you have the new features available in your environment. Other features requires, for example, data upgrades, because there are some features that work on data. And so this feature requires that you perform a data upgrade in order to be to enable them. And if a feature requires a data upgrade, you can also from the feature management page, you can schedule this data upgrade. And this means that if you enable a feature that enables a modification of data, it starts what is called the feature data upgrade setup. And from here, you can specify if you run it in the background and or, for example, execute that not immediately, but in a scheduled time. This permits you to don't affect the business process or something like that when maybe your users are working or feature or things like that. And when you have started a feature or enable a feature with data upgrade, you have also a new column that shows you how your data upgrade is performed. So pending data upgrade and completed data upgrade means that you can start using. Pending means that the data upgrade is in process, and when it's finished, you can start using your new feature. There are also some features called irreversible features. And these features are features that cannot be turned off. You can, are listed to you and cannot be turned off. And if you enable one of the features, a new alert will start to you saying that this is an irreversible feature that we cannot turn off this feature. Other features can be turned on and off. But some of them are called irreversible and they cannot turn it off. And the feature management also supports that. So for irreversible feature, it says if you want to enable it or not. Another interesting new features available in Business Central 17 is Business Central 17 has a lot of features related to the integration with the CDS, the Common Data Service. I think that you know that features like Dynamics 365 sales integration, the standard common data service integrations, and so on, rely heavily on what is called integration records, so integration tables that are present on Business Central. And these are fundamental blocks for creating integration between Business Central and the common data service. And this integration, if you enable this, sometimes is one of the main causes of performance bottlenecks, when especially when you have a lot of records and a number of operations between CDS and your business set antenna are high. And for this, in Business Central 17, to improve performance, you can disable integration records and integration management. And if you are not using them, and instead you can use standard system ID fields, for example. And starting from Business Central 17, important to remember that for new tenants, the integration records and the integration management features are disabled by default. So are not enabled by default now, are disabled by default. And if you want to enable them, you need to go into the feature management page and then enable the feature called performance disable integration management. If instead you have for existing tenant, so convert it to Business Central 17, you can upgrade and disable the feature management page by going the integration management by going to the feature management page and running the feature for disabling. So this is mainly for performance reasons. So you can, if you are not using integrations with CDS now, this is disabled by default, and you can enable integration records and integration management only when needed. Another important features, hidden. This is absolutely hidden, but I think that is one of the more, my opinion, one of the most important and great things that Microsoft has done on this release is that some frequently used reports, read-only reports, so statistic reports, now uses the read-only replica instead of the paper production database. So Microsoft has changed the definition of this object into the IL definitions by setting them to data access linked read-only. That means that they, as standard, they will not use the read-only replica of the database, but they, so sorry, they will use the production database, but they will use the read-only replica. This means that they will not affect the production database, but they will run in a synced replica of the database only, that is only read-only. Another new feature is that related to the retention policies. Now you can, with Business Central 17, you can specify, if you enable logs, for example, you can specify the retention policy of this log. So how frequently Business Central must maintain and then delete the data in log entries and in archive records. And you can specify also filters for these policies. So these policies then can, for example, if you change log entries, you have a button called retention policies, where you can define a filter on what you want to, an eventual filter on what you want to enable. First thing, you can enable a retention policy, and then you can eventually apply filters to what you want to delete. And in a retention policy, you can also specify the retention period. The retention period means that you have a retention period page where you can specify how much this data of the, on this table must be retained. And this is handled by you. So for example, if you can specify as in this slide that for the change log entry, I want to retain only the last 28 days and then delete. This permits you to save space into the database and also this affect performances. So it's quite interesting to enable a retention policy on this type of tables. Then we start talking about what's new for application. This covers the environment part, so the new features are related to the environments. Related to application, one of the main new features is what is called the Company Hub. The Company Hub is a central point where you can use to access multiple companies that you have inside your tenants, or not only this tenant, but also other tenants that you manage, where you can have access. And when you enable the Company Hub, for enabling Company Hub, you need to install an extension called Company Hub that normally is automatically enabled by default. And then you can have a page called Company Hub where you can apply filters. Just to quickly show this, if I'm going here on my tenant and just let me reduce the resolution and I search for Company Hub, you have a feature where you can first you can specify an environment link. This means that you can specify your environment where you want to access. This can be a single tenant or can be multiple tenants. So you can add here your tenants. And then for each tenant, you can select the company that you want to manage. And this is a quite useful point because it permits you to immediately switch from companies. So you can immediately click here and go to these companies. You can have here a set of statistics about this company that you can also customize, but this is the standards. And you can also apply user tasks to these companies. So have a list of tasks that you can do. And it's quite, it's like a central environment where you can use to all your company that you manage inside this tenant and inside all other different tenants that you can have. Also in different subscriptions. So this is like a central hub for managing operations. Other features related to this, there's a new feature to the Reto application. There's a new feature called VAT group management. This is an assisted setup that permits you to quickly set up and execute what is called intergroup submissions of VAT returns. So it permits you to handle this feature with an assisted setup instead of doing external operations. There's a new feature related to the item cost. So now you can specify that an item is of two other new types that are called service and non-inventory. This means that item where you can handle manually also the unit cost, and you can update the unit cost not only via procedure, but also directly manually by going to the item card or the stockkeeping unit page. Microsoft has also added a track package feature on different types of sales documents now. So you can go for example, into postal sales shipments or postal sales invoice, postal sales credit memo, postal sales return, and so on. If you one of the available actions is the track package actions that permits you to handle all the complete package tracking features enabled by default. And it's quite one of the quite requested features from a lot of companies. Another interesting feature is that in lots of scenarios, Business Central is used as the ERP of different subsidiaries, where maybe the main headquarter has a different ERP, for example, finance operations. And to enable the immediately consolidation of financial transactions, now there's a new feature available called the export consolidations that permits you to export a file of all the transactions of this company, and then automatically from finance operation, for example, you can import that file and you have an automatic consolidation of the transactions. This permits you to immediately share your financial statements with your subsidiaries without doing custom exports. And other features related to application is that Business Central now is available in four new countries. So Brazil, Ireland, Lithuania, and India. India is actually in public preview. So four new countries for Business Central 17. Now there are other features related to bank account reconciliations, where you can now cancel posted bank reconciliations. There are features related to payment reconciliations, where you can, for example, supporting employee ledger entries, and as features called preview posting, where you can simulate if this preview is okay. There are other application features related to specifying the dimension or recurring method and cost allocations. And another interesting feature is related to posting general journals, where you can now use a feature called copy selected lines to journals that permits you to create a copy of a general journal line in a batch for reversing transactions. So lots of new features related to batches and reconciliation, data corrections, and so on that you have in Business Central 17. Another interesting feature is related to the manufacturing, so for the premium version. is quite common feature that in the manufacturing environment where if you have a demand for an item, a finished item, this demand, if you analyze this demand also affects the demands of the components of these items. And who governs that? This is the levels of the BOM, because if you plan or an item at one level, this can affect all the demands of the derived components that were in the bottom levels and so on. And for ending this, Microsoft has, indeed, Business Center 17 has created a new engine for ending these cost calculations and this the demand for finished items. We have now a new field in the item card that is called low-level code that is used and evaluated for items that are inserted into BOMs. And this is used for ending the BOM hierarchy. And for this, you can enable an item calculations. So in the manufacturing setup, you have two new options for doing essentially two things. The first is enable these low-level code calculations by clicking the optimize low-level code calculations. This permits you to enable the new calculation of levels in the BOMs. And you can also disable the low-level code calculation by enabling these other fields that you can see on the left of this setup. And because in this way, you can, instead of real-time enabling this calculation, you can also demand this to a job queue, for example, to a job queue batch. So if you if you click the dynamic low level code calculation, if you disable this, you can have not an automatic calculation of costs for BOMs, but you can demand this cost to a background task, for example. Instead, if you enable, if you click the optimized low-level code, the new engine will take in place. And for applications, we about CDS. So if you are, we have said before that integration table are used for integrating with CDS. And now, when you enable CDS integrations, you need to map business central entities with CDS entities. And now in Business Center 17, the integration table mappings includes rules that permits you to control how the job synchronization works. And this means that on the integration table mapping page, now you can resolve conflicts. So this means that you have a page called integration table mappings, existing for also from Business Center 16. But now in this page, you can, if the integration between CDS and as Business Center has problems, you can see the two new columns, the resolve deletion conflicts and the resolve update conflicts. In the resolve deletion conflicts, you can choose what Business Center must do in case of deleted records, so if must be restored the deleted record or remove the coupling or do nothing. Obviously, if you do nothing, you need to manually resolve the conflicts. In the resolve update conflicts, you can choose if Business Central needs to update the data, or if CDS must maintain the data, or again do nothing. So manually resolving. So you can specify when the two entities exchange entities, who wins in case of update and who wins in case of deletions. So you can control this. And after you have specified the strategies, so the rules, and you can have a new page called Coupled Data Synchronization Error, where you can see the records that have problems or with synchronizations. And then you can From here, you can specify, you have a button called retry all that permits you to retry the synchronization again. So this is one interesting feature because you can automatically specify rules of synchronization and then retry these rules instead of directly manually fix all these integrations. And you can also, if you have, for example, something that goes wrong in the integrations, or you want simply to remove integration between some entities, now you can, again, in the integration table mappings page, you can mark all the entities that you don't want to synchronize with CDS again. And then you have a button for delete the couplings between these entities directly massively. So not one by one, but you can select all and remove the couplings by massively directly into the integration table mappings. Again, in this feature, you can also you have also the possibility to reset all your synchronization settings, and you have a button called Use Default Synchronization Setup, where you can directly reset all your synchronization options, and then move revert all to the standard entities, so standard synchronization rules. So a consultant can work directly on the integrations by specifying rules or by modifying some of them. Another big features that are now present, also again related to the CDS integrations, is related to what in CDS is called virtual entities. Virtual entities are entities in CDS that permits you to enable integration of data by representing this data in CDS as an entity, but without a replication of data. So this means that the tables with data is in Business Central, and CDS see this entity like a table inside the CDS, but it's virtual. The purpose of the virtual entity is normally to provide a way for integrating data without having this data stored on both systems. So this affects performance, it's much more performant. It's a feature available on CDS also for other types of applications. Now Business Center supports them, these features as by default. And all entities from Business Center are exposed as virtual entities to CDS. And so that means that the CDS see these entities like if they were physical, creating into CDS. And just remember that all is API based. So the underlying infrastructure for exposing this entity is based on APIs. And for enabling this virtual entity, you have obviously CDS in place. And all BCDS will be able to generate virtual entities based on the metadata or the API that Business Center exposes to him. So a very, very powerful feature if you work with CDS, if you use Business Center with the Power Platform or in the integration with the CRM and so on. Another interesting features for applications is related to background checks for financial journals. Now on the general journal batch, you can you have an option to specify that for this batch you want a background error check. This means that when you post something, automatically when you post this batch, you have a journal check fact box that appears to you and displays what is on the current line or on the whole batch. And you can have a fact box that shows you the problems, total number of problems that you have. You can click and fix this problem. And you have two actions that permits you to show the line with issues or all lines. So immediately you can directly see if your batch is okay or not okay and what are the errors inside your batch and fix them. Quite interesting for handling financial transactions or journals. There's a features actually hidden also for defining a list of fields that contains that permits you to define for a set of entities that you want for an entity. You can define a list of fields that for you contains business critical data. And for this entity, if someone changes this field, you want to be notified. And this feature is actually not enabled on all tenants. And if you enable this feature, you need to open a page called the Field Monitor Assisted Setup Guide that at the time of this speaking is not enabled on all tenants. And you should enable this by directly pasting this URL. So calling this from the URL. But this feature is quite interesting because in your business, you can select an entity and then you can specify that for these entities, if someone, for example, if you're in a bank account or record, this was someone changes the IBAN field, you want to be notified because for you is a business critical change and you will need to monitor them. Another new feature is related to items. To items, you have an item reference tables where you can now specify an item reference between your item description and the description that your customer or your vendor have. And this description can be also a long description. And so you can specify this link. And all your sales or purchase documents, as default, will show also the item reference number. So you can not show only your description or your number, but also the reference number of your vendor or your customers. This is a quite requested feature from a long time. You can also have, also related to application, conversion templates for converting contacts on vendors. So this means that if you have a contact now, you can directly click on create as. You can specify customer, vendor, bank, or employee. And for each entity that you select, for example, if you want to convert to an employee, you have a template. You can select that from templates. So you can specify templates. And this contact, for example, is converted to an employee based on the template you have specified. So with all the rules you have specified in this template, all the settings that you have specified on this template. So quite useful if you for converting contacts to entities. There's also a new features, a first level of this new feature, so expect more on this. But this business Delta 17 starts in the permitting you the integration with Microsoft Teams. Actually, the integration is quite basic, but it's the first level. And it's officially with Business Center 70s at this time is officially in a public preview. It will be officially released in December. This is the plans. Actually, what you can do is that you can in Teams enable the Business Center preview application, and then you can pass a link from Business Center to Teams, and then you can directly see details of this link inside Business Central. As an example, if I do this on my Teams channel, you can, for example, in a conversation, you can directly pass a link from Business Central. You are chatting with your colleagues, you pass a link on an entity, a preview as this entity is linked in links, you can click pop out and then going into Business Central page, or you can click details and then opening a preview of these details directly into Teams. Obviously, you must be logged. So directly into Teams, you can have a preview of this entity and directly working on this entity directly into Teams. This is what is actually available, but expect more on this. So quite useful if you are using Teams on your company, you are doing things on Teams. There are also a lot of improvements on the modern client. So, for example, actions are now present in lookup, in the lookup dialog in a particular way, quite different than before. The page inspector, the new Zoom, now supports temporary tables, and it's much more performant. In a report request page, now you can open multiple previews, one by one, without closing the main window. I think that one of the most important operations that Microsoft has done is on the role centers. The role center now opens more fast than before because many tasks are executed in background. So role centers now opens first the structure of the role centers, then visual queue, all the visual queue you have in the role center are opened, but the data they start by showing that the data is still loading because all the calculation is done in the background thread. And so you have immediately the role center and all the calculation that you have inside the role center will show later. So the user's experience is better because the user see immediately its role center and is not blocked on waiting that all the statistics that you have inside the role center are shown to you. So it's much more performant and you can go directly into the links without waiting that all is displayed. This is all about applications, all the new features about applications. Now, the last topic is about development, so developer side. As developer side, one of the new features is related to supporting the Azure Key Vault service for secrets. This means that all the extensions, you have often the needs to handle secrets. So to handle secret values that you need, for example, license key or something like that. And you have now a built-in support for reading these values from the Azure Key Vault service. And for supporting this, Business Center now is Business Center Online now is configured to automatically use an Azure Active Directory application called Dynamics 365 Business Center ISV Key Vault Reader. And to enable this feature, you need to do two things. The first thing, obviously, is creating an Azure Key Vault instance on Azure because it's required. You need to have this instance. And the second thing that you need to do inside your Azure Active Directory, you need to create what is called an Azure ID service principle that with bypassing the app ID or this Microsoft application, that is the app ID that you can see is in these slides. This permits you to authorize this Azure ID application from Microsoft to access this tenant. When added, you need to specify an access policy. So this application called Dynamics 365 Business Center ISV Key Vault Reader must have the permission to read your Key Vault. So the secret permission is set to get because it means that it can access and reading your Key Vault. And now, after enabling that, in the app.json file, so the manifest of your extension, you have an option, a new keyword, that permits you to specify the URL of the Key Vault that you want to access from extension. You can specify at least a max, it is an array. You can specify two instances because it's for mainly for backup and security reasons. So if one fails, you can connect to the other. And the first is the main. And by specifying that, you have a new code unit that permits you to manage the integration with your Key Vault. And this code unit is the App Key Vault Secret Provider code unit. And by declaring this code unit, you have a method called try initialize from current app that checks your Key Vault URLs, specifying the app.json, and connects to your Key Vault specified here. If the connection is okay, you can read the secrets directly by using secret provider.get secret and name of the Key Vault of the parameter. So just very quickly to show this using using the key vault means that you can specify a service on Azure called Azure Key Vault. And Azure Key Vault has an URL that you can you must pass on Business Central. And then on this key vault, you can specify the secrets you want. So for example, here I create a secret called license key with its value. You can click on here and specify other secrets by entering import them or directly import, filling the name here and the value here. And when this is specified and the connection is okay, from Business Central, you can read this key secretly directly from your extensions. So you can maintain all your secret data inside this instance of the key vault without sharing, for example, from extensions or from other applications. You can, a secret way is reading from the key vault and then storing, for example, into the isolated storage. Important in this slide is that my suggestion, if you have features procedure that reads secrets, mark this procedure as non-debuggable, because non-debuggable means that the debugger cannot go inside this procedure and no one can debug your for example, in this case, your retrieve license procedure and then see that this license key is this. So it's useful. Another feature that you can find in the new features available from Business Central 17, so more related to the new version of the IL language available with Business Central 17, that is the IL language 6, is related to the support of what is called code regions. If somebody of you knows also, for example, languages like C# or works with Visual Studio, knows that you can hide blocks into code regions. And now the IL language supports code regions. So as in this example, if I have a piece of code, I can specify a region with the name and the region as a kind of the block, and then you can collapse the region. So it's quite useful if you have a long code to separate blocks of code and then outline this code only when needed. Another interesting and a very important change with Business Central from Business Central 17 is that the new version of the IL language seniors knew that the with usage will be obsoleted in the future version. And actually it's a warning. So if you have code that uses with implicitly or explicitly, this means that your code you will start to show warnings into your code. So Business Central 17, IL language 5, no warnings. Now you will start seeing some warnings. As in this example, so if you have an operation that uses with, you start seeing that Visual Studio Code says you that the with statement is deprecated and will be removed in a future release. So actually there's an error in Business Central 18, it's a warning. In Business Central 18 will be an error. And removing with is important because with has problems in an extension world, because as in this example, just to explain the problem, in this example, I have a block of code where I'm using with, so with customer do begin, and then I'm calling a procedure called isReady, define local procedure defined here inside this object. All is working. Then imagine that a future my modification or a third party extensions adds a table extension to the customer table by adding an isReady methods, like in the bottom code here. If someone does that, your code is broken, because the IL language compiler checks the with first in the object scope. Object scope means that it checks for the entity that you are talking, so the customer table and the customer extension table, to resolve the usage. If it finds, it's a resolver. Otherwise, it goes to main method scope, so parameters and variables. Otherwise, go to the object scope, so global variables and global methods and so on. And then from object scope, it goes to global scope. Global scope means global variables, object, global methods and so on. So what happens here in this example? That the isReady called now is not the isReady into the local procedure, but the isReady defined into the table extension. This breaks your code, and you are not notified if you are using with. This is why Microsoft is removing that. Or in this example, if the isReady defined in the table extension is the same as the isReady defined locally, your code is broken, but you have no an alert because this is not a syntax error. But instead, imagine that the table extension adds an isReady method with a parameter. Your code is an error because it's resolved not by calling the local procedure but the table extension procedure. So important to do this, and the IL language extension now has an action to immediately fix this, so you can resolve the single with error or directly all occurrence of the with inside the objects. You can also have in Business Central now a new directive for handling warnings. So extension gives a lot of warning. You have the possibility to, in the app.json, to suppress warnings that you won't want to see in your projects. Now, I don't suggest to do that, but it's possible. You can add a directive called suppress warnings, where you can specify a comma separated list of warnings, and this permits you to avoid these warnings, at least maybe for temporary works. And you have also some new code directives that you can use in code. So pragma directive that permits you to disable a warning list inside the around the code sections. So this permits you to disable the warning not in entire code like the first suppress warnings option does, but only into the block of code that you are specified between these directions. Another absolutely important feature in Business Central 17 is related to the partial records loads possibilities. I think that you know that in IL you have a set of operations for reading data, get, find, and so on. And get, find, and so on, if you do something like find set of an entity, item find set, for example, this is on SQL, it's like doing a select star of all the item table. And more, if you have extensions, this is the select star plus joins with all the extensions that you have. Now you can, if you need it, you have an operation that permits you to load partially the record. So as in this example, I'm looping because I want to do a calculation into the standard cost of items. I don't need to do a select star of all my items plus the joins of all my item extensions. But I would like only to do something like select standard cost from item. And this with this instruction, you can specify item.setLoad fields and specify a little list of fields that your file set should return. And this is absolutely performance, more performant than doing the standard file set, because it loads only the feed you need. And this is performant for reading data when you have a loop that reads data. If you have a loop that modifies data or deletes data, this is not recommended, because when you want to insert data or delete data, the IL engine requires, and the database requires, the entire record. So the entire records must be fully loaded. And if you are loading set load fields and then you modify the item record, as in this example, the engines must then retrieve all the records. So it performs a new operation. So it's much better to not use set load fields when you need to do operations that modify the database. Another new features is related to the support of temporary tables. Temporary tables was in a Yale language, you have essentially two ways before, and then three ways to create a temporary table. You can, in the past, you can create a temporary table by setting the table type the record variable as temporary. So I can declare a variable of type item, record item, and then temporary as the keyword. This is a temporary table. You can create a temporary table by setting, creating a page and then setting a resource table temporary to as true. So it's a temporary, but these are only handled by code. And now you have an option more. So you can create a table into your IL language by specifying the table type as temporary. This means that you have created a table that is not physically creating into the database, but it's available to you. You can load data when needed and so on. It's a temporary table, so destroyed at the end of the object. And the advantage of that is that the table is always available for using. And the table schema, because it's not resident inside the database, the table schema isn't synchronized with the database. So if you modify fields from version 1 to version 2 of your extension, these are not breaking changes because it's temporary. So you can do also schema changes between version or extensions, things that you can do in a real table. So it's a new powerful feature for using temporary tables and for performance reasons. Another new interesting features available as a public preview again, is the Business Central Performance Toolkit extensions. This is an app that you can install your tenant from the app source, and this permits you to handle performance checking and track and compare performances between different builds, for example, of your solution. And with this extension, you can specify a set of tests or scenarios, and it permits you to run these tests not only in a single way, but also in parallel. So you can simulate, for example, different users that do things, what happens on your solution, if performances are okay or not. And you have also a command line tool that you can start from PowerShell for executing these loads and simulate things. So it's useful for creating test scenarios and for creating simulations of loads, for example, user loads, for checking that your solution, for example, stays fast and reliable from version 1 to version 2, or checking what happens on your solution when the volume of your users grows, and simulates, for example, scenarios that you have and so on. So it's quite interesting. On GitHub, if you search performance toolkit on GitHub, you have repositories where there are a set of predefined tests. You can also create yours and execute this test inside with the performance toolkit automatically, so for simulating things. And you can actually use the toolkit only in sandbox environment or on Docker. You cannot use it in a production tenant, so just remember that. But it's very interesting and useful if you want to simulate loads, in my opinion. And another interesting feature is that now when you uninstall an extension, you have a new button called Delete Extension Data, and this button permits you to delete all the extension data, so not only the data, but data plus schema, so data plus the schema of database. This means that you completely clean the database from your extension, and this is all removed. So it's up to you. And this can be done only by an admin. And another interesting feature is related to license check. License check means that before Business Central 17, you can create a sandbox with you can create a sandbox with, for example, a premium tier enabled, and your users can access this sandbox because the what is called the entitlements, the license permission, are handled in a table called entitlements, and this is handled only for enforced only in production. So sandbox has no checks for the entitlements. For Business Central 17, the problem is that many parsers that create and test extension using Sandbox maybe are not alerted of errors or something like that, or problems on your extension. And starting from Business Central 17, so this license check for entitlements is now enforced also in Sandbox. So if you don't have the permission to execute, for example, a premium version, you cannot test a sandbox with the preview now, because entitlements are enforced all the environments. Another feature that will be enabled in the next, actually in preview, expect more on this, is what is called the next snapshot debugging. Snapshot debugging is the ability to attach the Visual Studio Code debugger to a production tenant in order to take the snapshot of a code execution and then debug it offline. So what you can do with the snapshot debugging is that you can set a snap point in code, create a configuration attached to an environment, production environment, for example, reproduce some steps, and then download a file from Visual Studio inside the Visual Studio Code with all the stack traces, and then inspect this file offline. And actually, this release, this snapshot debugging is enabled only in Sandbox. It will be enabled in production environments in one of the first minor updates. So consider it as a public preview now. And with snapshot debugging, you need to do first create a configuration inside your launch.json with select initializing snapshot debugging or from on-premise or from cloud sandbox. And then start the section by IL initialize snapshot debugging. This permits you to connect and download the stack trace. Last section is that last new thing is the adding of data audit system fields on all tables. So all tables now contains last modifier odd, last modifier by, created by, and created all fields automatically enabled on all the entire database. It's one of the requested features now available on all entities. Now there's also a support for ISV telemetry. So on extensions, you can enable application insights, and then you can encode, use a feature called a new command called session.logMessage that permits you create a message and a log, and then send this message plus all details that you want to application insights for monitoring your extensions and or how your user uses these extensions. And remember that these telemetry can be sent to your instance of application insights or your instance plus the customer instance, so the instance linked to the tenant, according to the telemetry scope parameters that you have. So telemetry scope parameter is extension publisher, means that the event is only sent to the application inside that you as a partner as a specified into the app.json. Otherwise, it's sent to both. Now you can also set breakpoints in install and upgrade code units. So attach the debugger and also debug what happens on install and upgrade for checking what happens. And you can also rename an environment. So for example, from the sandbox 2 to new sandbox and something like that, if needed. So this covers all. This is what all the new things that you will find on Business Central 17 today. Some of them are in public review, as said, so test them, but expect them more things. And now this ends my part. So first question is, according to the database capacity, does this also include blob files? Yes, this includes also blob capacity. And as said, the database capacity is that shows in the ARM importer is now divided into two sections. One is called files and one is called capacity. Files is the amount of files, capacities of blobs and so on that you have stored inside your business central tenants, while the other section called database usage is only the data that you have inside business central, and of the sum of the two is the amount of space that your database uses in the cloud, and this is the sum of the two is what you pay for. So if you are under 80 gigabytes, it's okay, otherwise you need to expand them. Company Avis, for each tenant, you have different credentials. Can I still connect to each tenant with the same tool? Company Hub requires that you can, yes, you can add different companies into the company hubs, but if you have different credentials, when you try to connect, it asks for credentials because it works into with the credential stored into the main tenant. So if you have different credentials to access another tenant and when you try to open that company, it asks for the other credential. But yes, you can add them. If customer migrate from large database, what is the limit on BC Cloud storage? The large database that you can actually acquire on Business Central is limited by the actually available database on the Azure SQL. I think it's 2 terabytes actually the limitation. So you can acquire more space as needed until the limit of what Azure SQL now supports, and I think it's 2 terabytes. So yes, you can migrate with the space you want, but remember that you need to ask Microsoft if you want more than 80 gigabytes. Is there an limitation on the company size and company limitation? No, there's no limitation. So you can have the number of company that you want. Company size is limited by the space that you have inside your tenant. So you can have as many company as you want, and each company can have the size you want according to the space you have. So under 80 gigabytes, it's free. Over 80 gigabytes, you need to acquire more space as needed. What happens when a normal table is changed to temporary in the next version? No, in the next version, you cannot do that, because changing a normal to temporary, it's a breaking change. So you cannot do that. You can, if you have a normal table and you want to change them as temporary and you have an extension, this is a breaking change. So you need to obsolete this table and create a new table as temporary. You cannot transform an existing table to temporary. So suggestion, if you want to do this, obsolete the table, the normal table, and then create a new table, declare as temporary, and then you can handle this and also with all the breaking changes you want. Can on-premise ISV object range will work for SaaS? Yes, yes. And on-premise ISV, if you have an on-premise ISV object range, this can work on SaaS, but there's a but, only if you go on AppSource. So you cannot create an extension for SaaS with your on-premise ISV range and deploy this extension to your customer directly. If you want to do this, you need to be in the per tenant extension range. That means 54,000 to 99,999,000. Otherwise, you can use the on-premise ISV range, but you need to go through AppSource. Is it possible to get a copy of the slide? Yes, Eva will send the slides tomorrow. How will data audit system fields create be updated for existing records? That's a good question. I never tried this. I have to admit that I never tried this. So for new records, these are automatically filled by business trend. I've not tested if these fields are updatable. So if you can update these fields by code, I have to admit that. If you can update these fields by code, the solution is you can simply do that. But I've not personally tested if these fields are directly writable. But I'm not so sure of this. Let me just check. I will check this because now I will check this if I honestly don't remember if these fields are actually creatable by updatable by my code. Only since I'm trying in a direct way if it permits you to do that on my Visual Studio, but let me check. Yes, they are updatable. So yes, I just tested now. Yes, there are this field are updatable also by code. So you can do that by code. Rechange for remain possible removal of SMTP functionality. What do you mean by this? An idea, rechanges for remain and possible removal of SMTP. SMTP functionality is actually available because many emails sending relies on SMTP. So it's actually a feature available. Removal, I don't know if there are plans for removal now I don't think there are actually plans for removing these change them, it depends. Why always some new features doesn't work on production tenant? Because some new features are not enabled today for productions. So this is the reason. The feature management page is a page actually available for permitting to test new features, and it's only available on features can be enabled on Sandbox now, and this is why at the moment you cannot do that on Business Center. So some new features doesn't work on production as default because it's for security reasons and for it's just a preview of what will come in the future release. So it's just a way to share to all that you can in the next release you will have this feature or next community update you will have this feature if you want to test as a preview now before that the roll up you can do this or the right otherwise not. Can we use Company Hub with BC on premise? Company Hub with BC on premise, I don't remember. I think no. It's because it asks you to add an environment, and the environment must be an environment with Azure Active Directory, but I'm not completely sure of this. I think the answer is available only in the online version. Yes, it's, no, you cannot do that. It's just tested. What is the schedule of upgrading 16.5 to 17 on cloud? This upgrade is the upgrade to 16.5.2.7 is in progress, so it's scheduled for the next weeks. There's a bit of delay for this, but it's scheduled for the next week, so I think that you will start to see the upgrades in the upcoming weeks. I'm not a precise date to share, but the upgrade is scheduled for the upcoming weeks. So you will start to see, you can start creating new environments and new customers with BC 17 just now, but the upgrade, it's a bit delayed, and it will happen in these weeks because it started.
I think that we have already answered to all the questions which we had. So I would like to thanks very much, Stefano, first of all, for sharing with us the fresh information about Dynamics 365 Business Central version 17. As I mentioned before a couple of times, tomorrow we will share the recording and the slides with you by email. So thank you very much, and bye-bye everyone, and just word to Stefano.
Thank you very much to all. Thank you very much, Lieva, to inviting me today. Have a nice day and enjoy Business Central.